All right, it's time to give a huge shout out to the sponsor of today's episode, happyhippo.com. So if you guys haven't checked this out, you got to go to happyhippo.com because they have some of the highest quality kratom products that I've ever come across. And if you guys aren't familiar with what kratom is, it's an herbal substance that has many different uses, everything from a balanced mind to energy. It can help you relax. And my wife and I, over the last couple of weeks, have tried out some of their products. And I have to say, it has improved her sleep specifically. She's very anxious and her mind runs at night, and it has helped her fall asleep and stay asleep. She actually was using one of the powders that comes in a pouch from Happy Hippo and just dropped it into her water, and you know, off she went, and she was very happy, let me just put it that way. And so myself, during the workday, if you guys didn't know, I have a big boy job. I work in contract management, and I need that balance. I need the energy during the day. And they have something called Hyper Hippo and an energy shot. And those energy shots come in those little tiny bottles. You guys are familiar with it from other brands that use that type of packaging. But there's nothing like this, all right? This energy shot, I take it, easy to take. And within minutes, I feel the effects. There's no massive crash after I take it either, which is a huge deal, right? How many energy drinks have you taken and coffee have you drank throughout the day that just leads to the massive crash? Well, this doesn't. And it's an all-natural herb. And I'm telling you right now, it will help you get through your day. It can help you relax, depending on the type of product you're looking for. Happy Hippo delivers. And guess what? Right now, if you have an order of 200 or more, you can get free next day FedEx shipping. And also, their stuff tastes great. So check out happyhippo.com. Support the WWE podcast and Happy Hippo. And do yourself a favor as well, guys. I'm telling you right now, if it can help my wife go to sleep, for somebody as anxious as she is and as somebody that needs as much energy as I do during the day to do this podcast and to do my job during the day, check out happyhippo.com. Whether you're trying to relax or whether you need energy or balance during the day, happyhippo.com.
All right, everyone, this is Memphis Mark coming to you with a collision review on 8/19, and of course, we have the crew with us. We have Maintenance Maverick, and we also have Rocky T with us this week. So, Rocky T, how you doing, buddy?
Checking in once again. It's me. It's Rocky T. Glad to be back after 2 weeks off. You know, I'm glad you guys have been keeping up with it. As expected, we were going to have a rotating lineup here, and just glad to be back in the booth with you and Maverick. What's going on across the pond, man?
Not so much, man. Doing okay in the UK. Weather was actually pretty nice the past couple of days, but you know, let's get right into it. I'm kind of excited for this show. So first things that we had was, you know, the opening promos as they've been doing as usual. I kind of liked it, but it kind of felt like it's getting a little stale, almost a little too scripted to an extent. Mark, what did you think about it?
Yeah, the scriptness, I don't know if that's a word, but yes, it was a little scripted, but they're continuing on with it. I like it as far as that goes, and you can't expect it to be knocked out of the park each week. What did you think, Rock?
I'm still enjoying it, even though it seems a little scripted. I kind of feel like some of these guys are just, they have their footing set, but in a way, I think they're trying to make Collision feel, even though it's still an AEW product, they're trying to make it feel like its own entity. So maybe the scripted way that they're trying to showcase some of this talent is like a Collision thing and not versus a Rampage or Dynamite thing. So, but I'm still enjoying it.
Yeah, absolutely. And the first match, guys, we come out with Samoa Joe, the ROH television champion. And he's going against, a mask guy, golden, anybody get that name? Ninja, vampire, what was it?
I think it was the vampire, right, Maverick?
I believe they said the golden vampire, yes.
And then the logo on his ring gear was like fangs, so I'm pretty sure it was a vampire.
Wow, that's a lot of thought to put in for a run-in. But, guys, we had a surprise under the mask. Man, I tell you what, Rocky, since you've been gone from... little while, why don't you start us off on this? What did you think
Well, really, was it really a surprise? I know some people like to suspend their belief and act like it's a surprise, even though we kind of knew. I mean, the storylines just leading up to the All-In match that we're going to see between these guys. But I could kind of tell just from watching, you know, Punk all these years to kind of know his silhouette of his body. And then once he hit the knee in the corner, you just absolutely knew. If you didn't know by then you must not really be a wrestling fan. But, you know, again, I'm excited to see this match that's coming up at All In. I don't know if either one of you had watched their matches from ROH back in 04. I remember watching them back when I discovered Joe and TNA after Punk went to Rise in WWE. I remember going back and watching those matches they had, and they were incredible. So if anybody, you guys haven't watched them, I highly suggest you go back and watch those matches. These guys are a little bit older in age now. They can still go in the ring. They're going to tell a story, and that's what we're going to get from this match. It may not be a five-star bout, but it'll still be entertaining, to say the least.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mav, what did you get?
So from that match, I'll call it the first squash of the night, because let's be real, it was pretty quick. So something that I also saw online today about it was that I guess that was also a slight tribute to Edge, because I guess Edge and Christian at one point as a tag team went as the Los Conquistadors, I believe, and they both wore golden looking outfits. So I heard that was a slight tribute to him. I don't know how true it is, but I would completely believe it. CM Punk has given a lot of tributes over the years to different wrestlers, whether it just be his attire or just anything, really. He's done a lot. But overall, it was a good way to start the show. The only thing I didn't like was how his GTS looked. It looked sloppy, and it kind of bugged me to see it. And yeah, it just irked me a little bit, thinking, oh man, this could have been such a cool moment, but that botch right there just kind of killed it a little bit for me. But then hearing him call Smojo the B word, once again, this is a PG show, but it was pretty cool to see, like, all right, they're keeping up with it. And I'm really excited, because this means I get to see Samoa Joe and CM Punk live next week.
I'm so jealous.
Oh, yeah, man.
It's going to be packed.
Whew. Yeah. I tell you what, guys, I loved the Joe's reaction and that walk up the ramp. The walk up the ramp looking, you know, had its own cadence to it. It was pretty good. And I blame the botch on the polyester outfit. It's all the sweat and the polyester. But from there, they do an all-in promo, which has Cody Rhodes, which with Edge's promos during WWE this week, they had to have Christian on those too. So a little acknowledgement that other people are still out there. But, you know, a good little, you know, like Rocky-type build-up to Wimbledon with the all-in promo. What did you guys think?
They're doing really good with these video packages they're coming up with. I'm fully invested. So I'm counting on you, Mav, that we're going to live vicariously through you to get the full experience. Because, I mean, I don't buy pay-per-views anymore. So I'll just wait for this to be available on YouTube or whatever. But until then, you know, we're going to be living through you. And I hope we're going to have this set up to have that in-person review for next week.
Oh, absolutely. I actually bought a waterproof notebook just in case it's going to start raining there, because it is an open air arena, I believe. So just in case, I'll have all the notes and everything. I'll be watching right there live. So I'm really excited for it. And I think they're doing pretty well with these video packages and everything. They're really doing well hyping it up. And there's so much going on with hearing about Soraya talking about the last time she performed out in the UK and everything. And it's becoming exciting for even the women's matches that I'm excited to see what's going to happen, because I already gave my prediction, I believe, on last week that Soraya is going to win it and that it's going to lead to a feud between her and Toni Storm. But you know what? I just want to see a good show no matter what. But I believe that leads next into was Switchblade versus Dalton Castle. And I've always been a fan of Dalton Castle. But Rocky, you want to start on this one?
Yeah. So, you know, Bullet Club enters looking and acting obnoxious as always. And these guys, you know, very cocky, and I love it. Dalton Castle, I was only exposed to him once before. Was it maybe last year when Chris Jericho was the ROH champion and he was defending against past champions? That's the first time I saw Dalton Castle. I've heard the name a few times, so I know he's somebody I need to watch out for. But now that I've seen a full match of his, again, like I said, this was a good match, especially against a talent like Jay White. The one against Jericho was not as smooth, so that was something that I got to appreciate watching him. I love all the suplexes that he does, all the different variations. You know, there was a nice spot during the match when the boys did a double over-the-top dive to the outside. So this was very entertaining. Great showing for Castle in the loss. I just, you know, just look forward to seeing more for him. And Bullet Club being featured again, you know, this is – I mean, they're going to be synonymous with Collision, the way they've started off. With this match, including the next one we're about to talk to after this, Bullet Club takes up 45 minutes of the 2 hours of this show. So let me pass it over to Mark about it, and then we'll continue from there.
Bang, bang. Yes, the Bullet Club, buddy. I love it. I love it. And I love the cardboard J switchblade there. I love the fact.
Very that obnoxious. Yeah.
Yeah. And Dalton Castle. I have to hark back to the late, great Adrian Street. I heard several people discuss when they were talking about him, how you just stood back and let him run the match, because he would spend 4 minutes taking his outfit off, 3 minutes or 4 minutes riling the crowd up. And this is as close as you could ever do in modern day time to what Adrian Street did back in those days. So I really liked the whole show with him. And his talent in the ring is definitely, he's a past champion. So they couldn't let him just get squashed. So I thought this match was good. Yes, the boys come flying over. That was good. Everything about it. And the fact that Juice got to chase the boys around, hollering and screaming, because you never know what Juice is going to say. I'm a new Juice fan there. So, but yeah, it was, everything was good. I liked the match. A good sell on the end. I mean, everything I could ask for in a match. Now, what did you think, Mav?
All right. So I'm a fan of Dalton Castle. The first ever wrestling event I went to, it was an ROH event, and Dalton Castle was the champion. That's where I first got introduced to him. I had no idea what to expect. All I heard was the name, and then I saw pretty much what we saw tonight. And just as entertaining as ever, he's still the same guy. Absolutely love it. The pre-match promo, sort of, that was going on with Dalton Castle, where he's walking down the ramp, his music is playing, and they just have the camera in his face, and he's saying everything he wants to say. I enjoyed just hearing his obnoxious stuff that he wanted to say, things about, I'm going to suplex this guy's brains out of his butt, and even the commentary is kind of eating it up and going in on it. Like, man, I've never seen that before. Can you imagine what that would look like? Just back and forth to each other. Bang Bang Gang and the boys' antics outside the ring were pretty funny to watch. Even though watching in the ring was more entertaining, it's still funny to see the boys running and jumping outside of the ring every couple of seconds. I'm not sure if you guys were able to see it, but there was at one point that Dalton Castle was put up against the ropes from the outside, and he hit a some sort of Hurricane Rana style move, lifting himself up and then hitting it on Jay White. It was impressive athletically, to say the least, and just really enjoy that because it's not something I've ever seen, I don't think. And the boys defending Dalton Castle as usual, very entertaining, and hearing the commentary say they grew up and left the nest. Commentary's gotten better, and I'm really starting to grow fond of them. I will say the end, the Blade Runner looked a little bit sloppy, but the cell worked, so I didn't mind so much. And it kind of seemed like they may have cut it short because they knew they had some timing or something. But overall, good match. I really enjoyed it. And I believe this led into a quick promo for the Bang Bang Gang. Mark, you want to go in on that?
Yeah, the promo is going in basically on Hangman and Kenny Omega setting up for their match. But it does lead to the the guns trying to talk to a warm-up match that maybe they wasn't prepared for. What did you think there, Rocky?
Well, real quick with the promo, I really, really enjoyed Juice's facials, the way he, when he's expressing what he's saying. You can see that crazed look in his eyes, and I mean, you believe what this man is saying, and he backs it up in the ring. And like, with this Collision show, they're showcasing his skills. And so I'm starting to come around on him. I'm a fan of him too. I was a fan of his look since the first time that I saw him, and now I'm becoming a fan of his mic work and more of his in-ring work, which is, you know, kind of like the total package. These guys will be tag champs in the future. Going into the match, you know, it's just another showcase for these guys. Like I said, this Collision show, giving the talent the time they need to show their skills. I'm glad that the Iron Sandwiches got some, you know, they did get some offense in, but this kind of was a squash match. But with the offense that got in and the time they gave them, everybody got their spots. You know, they hit the finishers, and, you know, it was a good little match to eat up some more time. Like I said, the Bullet Club ate up 45 minutes of that first hour combined with everything that they did. So.
Absolutely. And Maverick, what exactly did that to the big guy for the Iron Savages? What was that remark?
So I believe I heard him say something along the lines of, call me ass boy, because I'm going to, and I'm not really sure how much they can walk the line here with things like that, but they seem to be doing it pretty well. No network seems to be shutting them down, so I guess just let them keep going with it. I like this match overall because I felt like the Guns improved a little bit on, first, their timing, seeing them set each other up to hit moves almost one is running to hit a clothesline. Maybe they miss, but then the other one is already coming up to hit a running knee or something. I really enjoyed seeing them do that, I guess, cross ring running around sort of thing, and it looked pretty cool to me. I feel like their selling was a little bit better in this match. That's something that I've always kind of nitpicked with them, and I feel like they're starting to improve on it. I think that even if they would have oversold a little bit, these guys were a pretty good size over them. If they would have oversold a little bit, it still would have been okay, just because, all right, so what, somebody that's Big Show sized slammed you and you rolled around for a minute. Yeah, that probably hurts. That makes sense. Overall, I really enjoyed it. There was some elite mocking and whatnot going on, and I enjoyed seeing that. And they really played nicely with the size of the Iron Savages. I enjoyed seeing that. The character of the Iron Savages, I guess, is kind of a gym bro sort of thing. I also kind of laughed at the fact that the commentary team brought up all the Tony Schiavone abuse that's been going on lately. Mark, what did you think overall?
I did like it. And the Iron Savages, you know, hey, you're right. This was more of a squash, but it was a respectable squash. And of course,
yes, agreed.
And Jay on the mic, the whole deal about them having to get him a headset and they wasn't prepared for, I agree with you, Mav, on the announcers are growing on me. They're growing on me quick. And of course, you know, they you know who's going to get this win. But you know, it was rather respectfully done there. I mean, Rocky, wouldn't you say respectfully?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It wasn't a total squash match. You know, they did get some offense in on Bullet Club, so it was a good showing for them. I don't know if they're going to be around it anymore or featured on Collision, but it was like borderline squash match. It was just another showcase for the Bullet Club. Just, you know, they can get some more chemistry together as a threesome or however they're going to team them up, tag team. You, Mav, I agree what you said about the Gun Boys. They are looking more smoother together, tag team. Like, I see the confidence in them now that I didn't see in them before when, you know, they were still with their father. Even though they had their father backing them then, it seemed like they were just having fun. Now they're in a more serious role, and their in-ring is reflecting, you know, that confidence that they have. So I would agree.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And they go from there with the House of Black and the Acclaim. And those doggone boots.
I'll take this one real quick, if you don't mind. Again, you know, AEW's putting a lot of stock into these video packages that they're doing. That's something that us, the fans, can really appreciate. If you're not watching week to week, which I don't, like I said, I don't get to watch every week to week live anyways. I'm catching clips. But not having watched live for the last 2 weeks or seen any House of Black, watching this video package reminds me what these guys are about. And this one was, you know, a little heartfelt because they were talking about Billy Gunn and him giving up the boots. The one thing that I took away from this was the last line of that video package where he says, rest in pain. So that's the one thing that stuck with me from that video package. But, you know, these guys are up there and they're being picked and honored to retire somebody. So you know that they have some backstage clout there, especially if Billy chose them to be the last match. And that's an honor in itself. What do you got on that, Mav?
So House of Black, I really enjoy them. They are giving somewhat of the supernatural feel that we used to have with The Undertaker and whatnot.
Yeah.
It's going well, and I like where it's going. They're going a little bit darker with everything. But one thing that I've noticed, and I'm a little weirded out by it, are they just obsessed with stealing other wrestlers' clothing or something at this point? A few weeks ago, we had Andrade El Idolo having his mask stolen. Now you have they stole the boots from the Acclaimed. Are they going to steal Ricky Steamboat's belt from Ricky Starks next? It seems like they just like stealing other people's clothing and making a big deal out of it or something at this point. But I do understand where it's going. It's enjoyable, but that was just something else that I noticed. So, Mark, what do you got?
All right, it's time to give a huge shout out to the sponsor of today's episode, HappyHippo.com. So if you guys haven't checked this out, you got to go to HappyHippo.com because they have some of the highest quality kratom products that I've ever come across. And if you guys aren't familiar with what kratom is, it's an herbal substance that has many different uses, everything from a balanced mind to energy. It can help you relax. And my wife and I, over the last couple of weeks, have tried out some of their products. And I have to say, it has improved her sleep specifically. She's very anxious and her mind runs at night, and it has helped her fall asleep and stay asleep. She actually was using one of the powders that comes in a pouch from Happy Hippo and just dropped it into her water, and you know, off she went, and she was just she was very happy, let me just put it that way. And so myself, during the workday, if you guys didn't know, I have a big boy job. I work in contract management, and I need that balance. I need the energy during the day. And they have something called Hyper Hippo and an energy shot. And those energy shots come in those little tiny bottles. You guys are familiar with it from other brands that use that type of packaging. But there's nothing like this, all right? This energy shot, I take it, easy to take. And within minutes, I feel the effects. There's no massive crash after I take it either, which is a huge deal, right? How many energy drinks have you taken and coffee have you drank throughout the day that just leads to the massive crash? Well, this doesn't. And it's an all-natural herb. And I'm telling you right now, it will help you get through your day. It can help you relax, depending on the type of product you're looking for. Happy Hippo delivers. And guess what? Right now, if you have an order of 200 or more, you can get free next day FedEx shipping. And also, their stuff tastes great. So check out happyhippo.com. Support the WWE podcast and Happy Hippo. And do yourself a favor as well, guys. I'm telling you right now, if it can help my wife go to sleep, for somebody as anxious as she is and as somebody that needs as much energy as I do during the day to do this podcast and to do my job during the day, check out happyhippo.com. Whether you're trying to relax or whether you need energy or balance during the day, happyhippo.com.
They're becoming kleptos. That was good. I liked it. But man, the video package they put together. Now, I do not speak, or do I claim to speak, as Spanish. So a lot of this I did not catch on the verbiage. But Roush is apparently ticked off. And he brought the crew to Mexico. Now, as far as the production on this, man, great job. You know, absolutely. Mav, we'll start it off with you this time. What'd you think?
All right. So I'll be honest, I have not been really following with Ring of Honor, and I don't know a whole lot about Roush. But honestly, with this, I was kind of starting to question, could this be setting up for a future show in Mexico for AEW? And if that is something to happen, how far in the future could it be? Could it happen? Maybe, but I'm not really seeing it in the near future. Otherwise, I'm a little lost with this one, honestly, because I didn't even recognize those two guys in this package. In all honesty, I haven't seen them on Collision up until now, so I was honestly a little lost. I won't lie about that. Rocky, did you have any more information than I did on that?
I'm in the same boat as you. I saw this, you know, I like the cinematic, you know, production of it, but I didn't know who these guys were either. And I'm a little ashamed about that, but if this is an ROH branded segment, then I don't feel so bad. You know, between everything in WWE, from Raw to SmackDown to NXT and then to Collision and some of the indies that I'm keeping up with, which I should be watching ROH or at least keeping up. I don't have anything on those guys. But I will be digging into it, and I guess we'll just see it play out over the coming weeks if they play the storyline out. But if this is the first we're seeing of it, I don't know if this is an extension, but if it's the first part we're seeing of it, you know, it's a good start. But we're just going to get some more information on these guys.
It was 10. I can't remember the name that he started going for from the Dark Order that was kidnapped. So, well, okay, it's an ongoing saga that we, all of us, will have to dive into a little more next week. But, man, guys, after that, you got Ricky Starks with Ricky Steamboat's belt coming out, and he's got a surprise for everybody. He said that he's going to raise a little chaos. So, Rocky, what did you think about this one?
I like how he got the backstage live talk, and then after that, he got a video package as well. The video package heavy on this episode. I liked Ricky Starks for a while now. I'm glad he's gone back to the heel, because I'm a heel through and through, so I'm glad he's going back that route. You know, just like how you said, he says he's bringing the chaos, and then what appears? Big Bill. So we get the video package after Big Bill appears. Big Bill is making his Collision debut tonight, and he's going up against some local talents. You know, it was a punch kick, roar, choke slam, 1-2-3, little squash match against, just now we know that he's behind Ricky. So that's what this was about, just introducing him to Collision. Maybe he's found a home here in Collision and he can really spread his wings. And with Ricky taking him under his wing, so to speak, you know, these guys could be a nice little force. Ricky's got a nice heater now, so we'll see what these guys can do.
Absolutely. Absolutely. What'd you think there, Matt?
So Stark's promo overall, I don't know. I didn't really see the point of them bringing up, oh, it's only a 4-week suspension. It's 28 days and everything. It's like, okay. 2 days less. I don't think anybody really would have paid that much attention or cared all that much, really. Ricky Starks still having the belt. It's kind of interesting that he's holding on to that. I expect that he's going to use it as a weapon in the future. Whenever the ref isn't looking, he's probably going to use it and, you know, attack whoever he's going to be up against. So Big Bill, this is another squash match, and I don't really have much else to say about it besides it was a squash. And Big Bill, he did okay. I mean, he still seems a little bit awkward even in this match where he's set up just to beat somebody down and walk out. The one thing that I noticed that he said during the match was, "You're going to hit me, huh?" to the other guy. And all I was thinking was, it's a wrestling match. It'd be a little weird if he didn't at least try to. This line just didn't seem like it fit, in my opinion. I didn't like it. Mark, what did you think?
Well, the jabroni in question, Derek Neal, was definitely a local guy. So he got his one punch in or whatever. But the only thing that I took out of this match is when Big Bill went to do his choke slam to his finishing move, he held that guy in the air. It seemed like 2 or 3 seconds before. I mean, the choke slam was the best I've seen him do. And if he can start doing it like that now, of course, that guy's smaller and it's a little easier to hold somebody up when you're 6'10", 6'11", in his size. But that choke slam looked freaking great. And then, yes, then Ricky gets to do a little whooping after the match and a little controversy going on there. But wow. Then we actually go to another Rocky. You said it, buddy. Video package heavy show, sir. But we got Darby and Sting showing up at AR Fox's local show, his local school, and kind of liked it. What do you think, Eric? We'll start off with you, Matt.
I'll be honest. I didn't see that. I'm not sure if maybe it didn't make the recorded side because I don't recall. I knew that it happened because of some online updates, but I didn't get to see it on the show itself. So I'm going to have to defer to Rocky on this one.
Yeah, it wasn't too long. Like how Matt just, I mean, Mark just described it. They showed up to the local spot where he's doing some training and put a little beat down. It's different. It's cool. So you have some big stars going to do an indie promotion, basically, and showing up, making a cameo, dropping the star who's in their storyline with them, which is Aaron Fox. And that was it. So something different, something cool. It kind of has like a backstage feel to it. So that's what I enjoyed about it. I don't know if they'll continue to do stuff like this, but like I said, something different. So
yeah, they're really putting a lot of a build up in Nick Wayne. That's for sure. Can you imagine being at, they call you and ask you to come down to the school because Sting and Darby Allin are going to come in and, you know, beat my butt around here for a little bit. We need some people in the actual arena. So that would have been a cool thing to
I think they were in a gym of some sort. Yeah,
you know, so that would have been cool to get that phone call to come down to. All right. I tell you what, Mav, you are a fan of Willow, so why don't you take Miss Willow's match here and start us off?
All right. So starting off in this match, after a few seconds, I started thinking about it, and I feel like Willow would be better as a heel at this point. Her character, it's running stale at this point. I don't know if it's just the dance partners or what, but Diamante, she's just not it to me. She's okay as a heel. I enjoy seeing her doing her mocking segments that I see. But other than that, I'm not seeing much from either of these two, or maybe I should say the three out of the four in this whole feud that's going on, because Mercedes Martinez doesn't really impress me. Willow's kind of fallen under the radar for me. Diamante is not doing very well, in my opinion. And Chris Statlander is the only one who can really hold to her name at this point. And I feel like maybe Willow turning heel and being more like an Awesome Kong character from the TNA days, that could be something. If she were to turn that into a more of a dark character and use a more powerful moveset, as she has the strength. She showed with how long that she held Diamante tonight with that brainbuster that she did holding her up in the air. It had to be for like 5 to 10 seconds, somewhere between there. It was interesting to see Willow hitting a dropkick. I'll give it that. And I think they're just setting up for a future tag team match. Rocky, what did you think?
I'm opposite of you tonight. Willow's actually growing on me. The only thing I agree with is that, yes, she would be better as a heel. She smiles a lot. She's kind of got the Raquel Rodriguez effect going on, just smiling a lot too much. But her in-ring is growing on me. But at the same time, since winning the Owen Hart tournament, I feel like she hasn't accelerated enough. It's kind of like in another holding pattern. But she is growing on me. The match, you know, the first thing I appreciated was the stalling suplex that she had, that she was holding. I always appreciate that move. It was a nice physical match. The clotheslines from both girls were very stiff. So this was the first time for me seeing Diamante. But she did have a great showing. I do look forward from seeing more from her. I like the pairing with Mercedes Martinez that they have. And I enjoy the mocking a lot. So she's actually on my to-watch list. And I might want to do some research on here. But how familiar are you with her work? How many times have you seen her? Because like I said, this is my first time seeing her.
So I want to say this is the second or third week that I've been seeing Diamante on AEW, and I just haven't been too impressed up to this point, but maybe she can get better. I'm not completely sure. Mark, what do you think?
Well, I think Diamante is as close as you're going to get to what is it, Tully Blanchard's daughter that's out there wrestling. The match was good, I guess. You know, having Mercedes show up and then Lander shows up, you know, it is what it is. Good match, I guess you could say. It wasn't high on my list. But they go after that. You got a Young Bucks and an FTR promo about the legacy match they have upcoming. And another package. But The Young Bucks, I just don't know. I just don't see them winning this match, but we'll have to see how this goes, but because they are the boss. But what did you guys think of the little promo here?
Well, Mav first, you're going to be there. Who's going to win?
So I'll be honest. I feel like the Elite's side are going to win. I feel like the Bucks are going to win now that they have signed a, I'm not sure if it's an extension or a new deal with AEW, but I feel like they're the ones who are contracted to the company. I don't believe that FTR are under any sort of AEW contract. I believe they're free agents who have just been there because they're the champions and they want to continue for the moment. But I ultimately feel like the Bucks may win this, and then that's going to be FTR's exit out of the company real quick. Because they've been here for a while, and as much as I love seeing them, I don't feel like they're completely tied to the company. As much as I would love to see them win and continue on, and I would love to see them against the Lucha Bros at some point, but I just don't think that they're going to keep it for too much longer. What do you think?
I'm torn, honestly. Since I started watching AEW, you know, since this obsession, that's when I was really introduced to the Young Bucks, and they've grown on me. I don't like that they don't sell a lot. I know they're trampoline wrestlers, but I enjoy how smooth they are together, the chemistry they have. Absolutely love their matches with Lucha Bros and FTR. Just, I've recently watched the first two matches between FTR and Bucks, and I'm just torn. I can understand the side you say. They are the company men. They are, you know, the VPs, so they might take it. They did sign the deal, so that kind of leads me to believe that FTR has been holding down for a long time, though. At the same time, you know, whoever wins this match is really going to cement a legacy, and not just AEW history, but tag team history as a whole. So I'm torn. I feel like I'll be happy either way, but I'll also be disappointed either way. So,
yeah, that's probably a good way to put it. Either way this goes, you're going to probably get a good match. So, I'm kind of there with you. Either way it goes, but after that, we have Ms. Tony Storm doing a shoe throwing promo.
What's up with the accent? Yeah, well, how long has she been doing that?
In the Middle East, that throwing that shoe is a big deal. So she would be in all kinds of trouble over there. But
Tony was Australian.
Yeah,
she is.
So, what did you guys think of it?
Not much all for right. me, really. Go ahead, Matt. You take this one.
So with her look right now, and after the last few weeks of her coming, showing up as almost a housewife or however else we've been describing it, with the way her hair and her outfit looked, I was starting to question, is she becoming a Cruella de Vil from 101 Dalmatians or something? She's got all the black clothing. She's got the blonde hair that's, I'm not really sure how to describe how it was styled besides curled on top. There wasn't any Tony Schiavone abuse, which is kind of a nice touch, but, you know, it's just, it feels like the interview is missing a little something because of it. But throughout the interview, Tony was basically talking about that she trusts Saraya, and I feel like it's a little bit too much. It's somebody who's been a good heel for a while. I expect Saraya to turn on her. It's just going to happen. Rocky, what do you think?
I'm just excited to see how it's going to turn out. Yeah, the Saraya turn feels like it's going to happen. I didn't think these girls were going to last that long. I did like them as heels, you know, the trio. Versus when they were baby faces, I liked them more as heels, but this new thing she's got going on with the hair and the clothes, I'm not a fan of the accent at all. So maybe the turn is the best best for everything. But when that happens, where does Tony go from there? You know, I know she's trying to be a 3-time champ going into this match. I'm not sure if she's going to take it or not, but we'll have to see how this one plays out. And then what happens to Ruby Soho? Whose side did she take? You know, so a lot of different ways this thing can go. We'll see what the future brings.
Yeah, first of all, Tony Storm's got to get some more shoes because she keeps throwing them at everybody. But guys, you got Powerhouse in the house going against the Tattoo Jabroni.
Kevin Koo.
Yeah, it's first AEW match, and from what the announcer said, trained in the Killer Kowalski camp. Let's start it off. Rocky, you want to take this one first?
This is our third squash match of the night. The only thing I took from this was that Hobbs looks in phenomenal shape, and I really liked how he was yelling Miro's name into the camera during the match. And then, of course, we get Miro appearing on the big screen there, and it cuts his promo. I didn't know that this was a thing. Like I said, I've been out of the loop for a minute. As soon as I heard him say Miro's name, I was like, hold on, though. Is they really saying Miro's name? And then he appears on the screen, and I instantly, like, I'm excited for this match. These guys have incredible talent. I know there's going to be more than one match between these guys, the first one at All In. I hope it's not a one-off. What do you think, Maverick? You excited to see this match? You're going to be there.
I am excited to see it. I'm a fan of both of these guys, so I'm happy to see wherever it goes. I'm a little confused, and I think that's kind of what they want for which way Powerhouse Hobbs is going, whether he's trying to side with QT Marshall or not. I'm a little lost with that, but I'm happy to see where this is going, and I'm happy to see a match between Miro and Powerhouse Hobbs. My notes for this match, honestly, this is the third, technically fourth squash of the night. Am I really paying for squashes at this point? I don't want the whole show to just be reliant on squash matches, you know? I feel like they're becoming almost reliant on it. What do you think, Mark?
Yeah, it was a little squashy tonight. But, you know, it is what it is, because it's going to lead us to, first of all, they got to bring JR out for this main event. So when they get JR out, they probably have to help him get down and settled in. You get a match between Darby Allin and Christian Cage and Luchasaurus.
Yes, real quick, Mark, I got something to point out.
Oh, please.
Before this match, they were advertising all the matches for Fyter Fest this Wednesday and then for All In. They made a little typo there. So what they did was on Dynamite, they advertised the Aussie Open defending against the ROH tag titles against the Hardys. Then they advertised them defending them on Saturday at All In. I mean, on Sunday, the pay-per-view at All In against Cole and MJF. So that just tells us that the match against Hardy is literally a literal throwaway. Mm. Did y'all catch that?
I did not.
I did not see it, honestly. But yeah, that is a pretty good showing of, well, we've already got the schedule. We already know who's going to win that one.
Yeah, so, I mean, if they would have showed the graphic of All In with the Aussie Open, you know, and then the Hardys, and then if they had not announced that, you know, MJF and Adam Cole will face the winner of this tag team match at Fyter Fest on Wednesday, then it'd be more believable. But them advertising over the match on Wednesday just gives it away. So, very big mistake there.
That's a big typo. And I'm glad you caught that, because I sure as heck didn't, but... they just totally screwed that up. And I wonder if they'll go back and if they noticed it, if they'll go back and do something to tweak the match up a little bit, you know, to change it up so it's not so.
At the very least, on Wednesday when the match happens, all they got to do is say the winner of this match faces MJF and Cole at All In. That's all they got to do.
Yeah. You know, that or either one of the Hardys is injured or something. There's all kinds of stuff. But, okay, guys, as I said, we're going into our main event. Mr. Turtleneck himself, Christian Cage.
Love it.
So, I've got a whole page of stuff I could sit here and talk about, and you guys do too, probably. So,
I got two things. First of all, my back hurts after watching this match. Those two bumps that Darby hit, the drop kick to Christian sitting in the chair and the coffin drop to the apron. I mean, those are the highlights of the match. It was a good match, but my back hurts. But you guys, you know, so start us off, Mark. What you got?
Man, I got to say that Darby Allin just... I want to not like him, but he's just so believable. He's so quick, and the way he does things, like when he's got a bigger opponent, the way he'll wrap that leg around and bring the guy down to his level, all of these little things, I think, it just make him what he is, you know, a great wrestler. But man, I thought that when Christian was going after his shoulder and really started. You know, going into it, I figured excuse me, that Luchasaurus would be more involved. And I think Luchasaurus actually just kind of looked weak on the outside. Even when he got kicked out, he hit his chair, hit one of the chairs against the post. And it was like, pow, pow. I've been kicked out. It just wasn't there. But as far as the match, wow. Like you said, the drop kick in the chair, the coffin drop, everything about this match was good. And it shows Christian can still go, man.
Absolutely.
Oh man. Darby did try to get the turtleneck off of him. I think he said he was going to choke him with it, or I forgot what he said, but he did try eventually. But yeah, man, Christian is just a good vet that showed a great match in this. And the pin, the jackknife pin, everything was good. Good. And even after the match, they do a little jumping and pumping on him. And of course, with Luchador still picking Christian up over his shoulders in the celebration afterwards. I love it. Christian has, I don't know if he's writing this or who's writing it, but I freaking love it. Now, Maverick, tell me something. Tell me if I'm lying.
You're absolutely right, Mark. And seeing Darby doing that drop kick to Christian Cage in the chair, that was the first I've ever seen something specifically like that. And then seeing him take that hard spot on the apron. Yeah, you're right, Rocky. That it hurt my back to see it. And kind of started making me think about a young Jeff Hardy who was trying his best to really get his name out there. And he was doing all the extreme spots that he could. And I got to say, Darby, I appreciate that you're trying for us, but don't kill yourself, man. Your body's only going to last you so long until it's broken. Don't want to end up like Jeff with a tailbone issues at this point, because he used to take care of his opponents a lot more than himself, and now he has tailbone issues from when he does Swanton Bomb too many times. But yeah, overall the match was good. Seeing the spear from Cage, or I guess the attempt, I can't remember which at this point, but could that have been a slight Edge tribute as well, knowing that he is going through his retirement right now, which I personally don't completely believe that Edge is entirely done. I feel like he may leave WWE at the moment. But Darby winning with that jackknife, that's the first I've seen of something like that. It seemed like he just clung on to the back of Christian and just rolled him over that way, almost like a cat or something, flipping himself upside down that way. Not something I really see too often. I also enjoyed seeing Luchasaurus and Christian's head games throughout it, and I really loved seeing Darby pulling the turtleneck over Christian's head for a second, making him look like a legitimate turtle for a minute. I just got a laugh out of that. Rocky, what did you think?
Like I said, it was a great match, entertaining. These guys are high caliber athletes. Christian, you're right, Mark. Christian can still go. He still got it. Would really like to see him actually capture that TNT title, or even beyond that. You know he's going to eventually come back to WWE on a legend contract. There's the rumors of Edge going to AEW to tag with them. Me and the Gardener actually had a fantasy booking where Christian would be Edge's final match. That Christian would return to WWE to face Christian. I mean, to face Edge over there. But I don't know the extent of his contract. But overall, you know, I think Darby's gonna take the win at All In and capture that title. And you know, I think this will make it a 2-time champ, or yep. Maybe it's 2-time. So yeah, I think it's. He's more than paid his dues over again since losing the title. So he's, you know, he deserves it. So I'm expecting him to win. Christian, great work as always, you know, with the heel tactics. I love that he's still wearing the turtleneck as his ring gear now, just like, you know, every week. So really happy with that. And then just to what you were saying about Edge and him not being WWE, I believe this is just going to be his farewell tour, kind of like the Great Muta did. He had his last match in New Japan. He went on to another promotion and had a last match there. And then he had another last match at, you know, with the Forbidden Door. So I think this is just the start of Edge's farewell tour. But I don't know if Tony Khan puts enough zeros on that check. He might make a little 1-2 month cameo in AEW. And would anybody be mad at that or hold it against him?
No, but I tell you. In September, the new company takes over for WWE, MMA fighting. They all get together, and it officially becomes one company in September. So there's a lot of people expecting a lot of cuts coming from WWE, financial cuts and people getting cut. So maybe by the end of September, because of budgets and what they're doing, they don't want to pay that contract, and Edge pops up in the AEW for, you know, a match or two. I wouldn't put it past, but we got a lot coming up with this merger and everything coming up next month. And then, of course, Vince just having his surgery. So it's a lot of things going on, guys. So, man, I tell you what, guys, I think did we get to the show?
We did, and maybe in record time this time.
Wow. Wow. Okay. Well, we are done with the actual show, but I tell you what, guys, do you got any final thoughts of what you thought about the show? I mean, Maverick, we'll start off with you. What was your, you know, pretty much a take of this week's Collision?
So this week's Collision, well, I guess one way to put it is it was a squash fest along with a video package fest, and enjoyable to an extent, yeah, but I would give it a C rating personally. It wasn't great. There wasn't anything incredible to me besides Darby Allin, Christian Cage, and the first couple of matches with the Bullet Club, because everything else felt pretty much like squash matches to me. And yeah, it just wasn't as great as I felt it could have been. Rocky, what did you think of the show overall?
Yeah, it was squash fest. What I would rather have seen than that, because on one side, you're building up Big Bill. Other side, you're building up Powerhouse Hobbs. What I think I would rather see instead is have Bill versus Hobbs. Even if you do 50-50 booking for a couple of weeks to build them up against a credible opponent versus these squash matches, I think that would almost be better. I'm really enjoying the video packages because that's the part of the business I really like, is the behind the scenes and how they get the stuff out. Getting you invested without having to keep up every week. You can be invested watching one video package and be reinvested in whatever's going on. So, you know, we have one more Collision before the pay-per-view next week. We'll see what they bring, what happens during the week, and what they bring, you know, as the go-home Collision before the pay-per-view. And overall, I think we're right there at that C, maybe a C-plus rating. But like I said, there was a lot of build-up to the pay-per-view.
Yeah, that's their all-in on that, literally all-in on that. For the big show, and the tickets look like they're doing good, so it should be, Mav, you should have one heck of a time. That would be something that I would love to go to myself. So we're gonna live vicariously through you at that, and you need to either tweet a lot, or I guess, do you say X a lot now since they changed the name? When are you gonna? That doesn't sound right. Never mind. Yes. Yeah, never mind. Yeah, because the third time you're getting into a whole nother subject. Never mind. Hey, Maverick, why don't you let the guys and gals out there know where they can contact you, sir?
All right, guys. So I guess we'll start off with just letting you guys know you can, as usual, find me on Twitter. I am at MaintenanceMav. You guys can message me about anything. Doesn't necessarily just have to be wrestling. And yeah, I'll be happy to talk pretty much about everything. So I'd like to give a quick shout out to this Miss Jennifer lady, who has been making my Uncle Mike the gardener a very happy man. So appreciate you doing that, putting a smile on his face. But also want to talk about something a little bit more serious. So last week, before we did our Collision review, I was very stressed out. And it was to the point where part of me was kind of wondering, like, do I even want to consider, you know, cutting off, maybe doing these podcasts for a little bit or something. But I gave that one last shot, and honestly, it helped unload everything that was on my back. So I appreciate everybody on this show, everybody who's listening. You guys really did help me through what was been bothering me, because it was between work and things outside of work. And man, I've just been tied and really fighting everything it felt like in life for a little bit. So thank you all for being a part of that. Rocky, you want to say, your stuff, man?
Yeah, I second the shout out to Miss Jennifer with the gardener. If you don't know, You can find me at Rocky's Club 007 on the X. Just send me that X message. And, you know, we have a lot of irons in the fire right now with the rest of Magic Crew. As you know, coming up, we have, you know, not everybody can be a top guy. Mav, that's your brainchild that we're going to publish out pretty soon. We got a couple other things in the works. You know, shout out to King Scully. We have, you know, maybe you could be on next week with us. We got your episode that we're working on too, which is going to feature the UK wrestling influence on today's wrestling and how all that came to be. We have another episode that's supposed to piggyback off of DJ Kuzmo's episode of the theme songs. This one's going to be with Mrs. Rocky T covering all ring gear and some backstage, the makeup artists of some of these wrestlers. We're going to get some of that information out, who these people are, and, you know, touch on some of that stuff. But other than that, shout out to the Gardener. You know, I'm glad you're back in town, buddy, and look forward to that next episode and pumping out everything else that we got going on. Mark, why don't you just close us out?
All right, guys. Well, I very much enjoyed the show tonight. And I tell you what. Normally I would give my Twitter /X/ address. Refusing to get the check mark has gotten the account frozen. So we'll have to see how this saga ends. I may have a new address there. So I won't give one this week. So we'll just go straight into the close. And that is, guys, thank you very much for listening. If you can, get out there and help a foster, or help a dog pound, as they prefer it in our city now. They just called it that again. But anyway, get out and help and spay and neuter. And guys, for the crew and everybody here, man, guys, I guess we're out.
All right, it's time to give a huge shout out to the sponsor of today's episode, happyhippo.com. So if you guys haven't checked this out, you got to go to happyhippo.com because they have some of the highest quality kratom products that I've ever come across. And if you guys aren't familiar with what kratom is, it's an herbal substance that has many different uses, everything from a balanced mind to energy. It can help you relax. And my wife and I, over the last couple of weeks, have tried out some of their products. And I have to say, it has improved her sleep specifically. She's very anxious and her mind runs at night, and it has helped her fall asleep and stay asleep. She actually was using one of the powders that comes in a pouch from Happy Hippo and just dropped it into her water, and, you know, off she went, and she was just she was very happy, let me just put it that way. And so myself, during the workday, if you guys didn't know, I have a big boy job. I work in contract management, and I need that balance. I need the energy during the day. And they have something called Hyper Hippo and an energy shot. And those energy shots come in those little tiny bottles. You guys are familiar with it from other brands that use that type of packaging. But there's nothing like this, all right? This energy shot, I take it, easy to take. And within minutes, I feel the effects. There's no massive crash after I take it either, which is a huge deal, right? How many energy drinks have you taken and coffee have you drank throughout the day that just leads to the massive crash? Well, this doesn't. And it's an all-natural herb. And I'm telling you right now, it will help you get through your day. It can help you relax, depending on the type of product you're looking for. Happy Hippo delivers. And guess what? Right now, if you have an order of 200 or more, you can get free next day FedEx shipping. And also, their stuff tastes great. So check out happyhippo.com. Support the WWE podcast and Happy Hippo. And do yourself a favor as well, guys. I'm telling you right now, if it can help my wife go to sleep, for somebody as anxious as she is and as somebody that needs as much energy as I do during the day to do this podcast and to do my job during the day, check out happyhippo.com. Whether you're trying to relax or whether you need energy or balance during the day, happyhippo.com.
Thanks for listening to the WWE Podcast. Don't forget to subscribe on your favorite podcast app so you don't miss a show, or head to WWEpodcast.com. And for all of these shows ad-free, head over to patreon.com/WWE Podcast. Until then, we'll see you next time.